Brian. Put that here. Thank you, Brian. Today it's about storytelling. This morning is going to be storytelling, and I realize that when someone stands up behind this auspicious podium, ostensibly to talk about some theme, that you're justified in expecting that you're going to get some moral or wisdom out of it. And I regret to say that I haven't really prepared this talk too well towards meeting your goal. But so if I can throw in some little moral or advice on the theme I'm about to talk about, it would be twofold. Number one, zealously pursue small delights and diversions, especially little artistic ones. Make stuff. Fiddle with beautiful things. And number two, maintain your connections with people. Develop and maintain connections with people. Now, I'm really good at number one, fiddling with stuff, notoriously so. Number two, I'm not instinctively good at maintaining connections with people, but sometimes number two follows from number one in kind of unexpected ways, as I hope I'll be able to tell you in this talk today. But before I get started, I need to describe the little boxes that you see in front of you, and I made these laser cut ones over at Make ATX. What these are called quest boxes. They're reverse geocache puzzle boxes. And what they are, they are boxes which are sealed from the inside. These cannot be easily opened, as in the state that they are now. They have some electronics inside and some GPS-enabled electronics, in fact, that requires the recipient of this box to take it to a certain location in order for it to be opened, in order for that person to discover what treasure you've hidden inside the box. And the only way the person can discover where that location is by pushing the little button, which I have currently taped up. If I had two hands, I would untape it and show it to you. There's a little button on here that activates the electronics and turns on the little display here, which tells you one thing, how far away you are from that destination. So given just that clue, you've got to figure out where you need to take this box in order for it to open, in order for you to see the treasure. So it's designed for you as the owner of the box to give it to somebody else, to send them on a quest, to send them out into the world to see if they can figure out where this location is, be it down the street here or in South Africa. You know, you can set it for any destination you choose. And just as an extra little interesting quirk, you can only push the button 50 times before the box seals forever and can never be opened. So that's the reverse geocache puzzle, and I'm going to talk about that a little bit today. So let's get started. So I have this brother, a very smart and very focused young man. We get along really well, have ever since we were very young, and get along so well, have such rapport with each other that it sort of seemed self-evident that at some point we would collaborate on some big project and make something wonderful that would revolutionize the world. Now, having a really smart, really focused person on your team is as you can guess, is a pretty useful thing. So I was always kind of looking forward to this collaboration that we were going to do someday. And unfortunately, I'm his partner in this adventure, so and I am completely unfocused and can never pay attention to the tasks that I need to get completed. So we have never collaborated yet. I'm 50 years old, still waiting for this collaboration to happen. I doubt if it's going to happen just because I can't focus very well. In fact, I should be focusing on changing slides here. There's a picture of a reverse geocache puzzle with the button visible. It's sort of become a family joke, you know. We'll be working on something and my brother will come around the corner and catch me playing with my fractal software or soldering something or or making new covers for my cassette tape collection, or making a, you know, stop motion Lego movies or something. Michael, you're fiddling again. Unbelievable. You know, you got to quit your fiddling. So it's kind of a family joke that's kind of embarrassed me over the years. But, you know, as I get older, I start thinking how much that enriches my life and what a key component that fiddling is in my happiness. So when I stumbled across this lecture by the amazing Tim Minchin the other day, where he said something almost exactly along these lines. He said, I advocate passionate dedication to the pursuit of short-term goals. Be micro-ambitious, he says. Put your head down and work with pride on whatever's in front of you, but just be aware that the next worthy pursuit will probably appear in your periphery, which is why you should be careful about long-term dreams. If you focus too far in front of you, Tim says, you might not see the shiny thing out the corner of your eye. Wonderful. So now, if you'll bear with me, I'm going to tell you the story of how my propensity for fiddling, that is, you know, pursuing those small delights and diversions I mentioned a minute ago, has kind of landed me in an adventure which has connected with me with hundreds of people, kind of turned my life upside down, and it's been going for 6 years and shows really no signs at all of abating. So let's go. About 2006, my college roommate, longtime friend and business partner, Chris, in the short span of just 2 years, stunned us with the news, A, that he was abandoning his lucrative software career in Austin to move to New York City to become a penniless film student. And then, not 18 months later, that he was abandoning his penniless film student career in New York to move to Paris to marry the French model that he met who was starring in his student film productions. So, given that kind of auspicious news, I decided naturally that I better go to this wedding, even though it requires, you know, traveling overseas. And furthermore, it probably would be better if I didn't bring a linen napkins or a toaster oven or something for a wedding present. So I decided I would see if I could make a wedding present. And at the time, I happened to be fiddling with GPS technology and fiddling with sort of basic robotics, you know, servo motors and things like that. And somehow the idea to make a little box that contained the wedding present but couldn't be opened at the wedding but had to be taken somewhere else occurred to me. So I excitedly put this box together and put some cute little wedding things in it and a little sentimental letter, and I gave it to them at their wedding. And this was the first reverse geocache puzzle box quest. I selected this tiny island off the coast of France in the English Channel there. You can see it, it's the end of the red line over on the left-hand side, 500 kilometers away from Paris where the wedding was. Not a completely random choice. I happen to know that the bride's family had a little house there, so it was likely that at some point they would go there anyway. But this is a fascinating story that I don't have even near time to talk about here. It's written up elsewhere, but suffice it to say that it was dramatic and fun, and it took them 10 months to figure out where their wedding present could be opened and to actually get out there and open it. Because you can't just solve the problem. You actually have to take the box and go there in order to, you know, you can figure out that it opens at this little island on the coast of France, but you still have to go there in order to get to the present. So as you can imagine, I was pretty proud of this little project, and it got me quite a bit of delight, very diverting, very fun. So the first thing I did when I got back to Texas was I wrote it up naturally on my little blog. And this is kind of where the story, from my point of view, gets kind of exciting, because immediately what happened was Gizmodo and Engadget and Make and a bunch of these little kind of tech blogs pounced on it and reprinted and linked it. And so suddenly I was getting 100 times as many hits on my website as I had before. And then these little connections that were starting to form just kept growing. A fellow called me out of the blue from the Los Angeles Times science desk asking if he could interview me for a feature article in the Sunday tech section of the Los Angeles Times, which, sure, I'll be happy to do that. You know, all completely unpredicted by me. Here's the original article he wrote up. A Hollywood producer read the the Los Angeles Times article, called me, said, "We think that this would have the makings of a major motion picture along the lines of National Treasure. Do I have your approval to pursue this?" Okay, sure. You know, some guys from Discovery Channel Canada called about the possibility of sending down a film crew to interview me about this. A video crew from the World Geocaching Organization came down from Seattle, and we had a little put together a cute little movie. You can still see it on YouTube if you search for reverse geocache. And then I don't know how many of you were at Richard Garriott's talk just 3 months ago at this very podium. Richard Garriott called me up and said, "I'm getting married, and I'd like to commission a box for you, for my wife, to send her on a little adventure." And this is a photo that has never been seen by anybody. And he sent it to me from Paris just after they landed in Paris. This quest that they solved, that she solved, I should say, he set it up, still has the record for the longest puzzle box quest in history. It went from Austin to Paris. We made a special version that you had to stop in Paris on the way to Botswana. Yes, that puzzle box there has at this point has not been opened. It contains her wedding gift, which I still even don't know what it is. But that box eventually opened out in some safari camp in the middle of Botswana, and that's how she got her wedding present from her husband Richard. So on and on and on, the connections keep growing. I can tell you that this just keeps burgeoning. Right now, I'm working on 5 different projects that are indirectly related to my fiddling with GPS technology, fiddling with puzzle boxes. I'm working with the Arduino core team to build Arduino software. I've got. I just wrote an article for Make Magazine, my second one, on using GPS technology. I'm working with this fabulous team of old guys in England, who like to go out on a Saturday morning and take a weather balloon laden with electronics and cameras and send it up into the stratosphere. And what my software and hardware does for them is as the balloon is ascending and drifting away, it is sending little transmissions about telling, "Here I am." If you want to plot the balloon's path on a Google map, you can plot it. This is a wonderful project. The balloon gets up to 30 kilometers, so high that you can actually see the curvature of the Earth and the blackness of space. And it takes these high resolution photos, and then of course the balloon pops and it comes parachuting down God knows where, but God does know where, because my GPS stuff is sending transmissions back to the base camp. And I love the way these guys operate. They launch the balloon, they go off to the pub, they sit and drink beer watching it on the Google Maps until it tells them, "I've landed, come get me." And then they hop in their car. I don't know how I like the way that sounds. They hop in their car and drive off and collect the balloons and collect the remnants of the balloon, all the cameras and all the great photos. Just a couple of weeks ago, I hooked up with a team of scientists from the University of Vienna who are using ultra-high precision GPS to map an underwater Paleolithic archaeological site. So here's how this works. A diver goes down, pokes around hunting for remnants of some, I don't know how it got underwater, but apparently at some point it wasn't underwater, remnants of a Paleolithic civilization. Civilization's not quite the right word there, I think. Paleolithic place. And when he finds an artifact of some kind or something notable, the diver grabs a cable, which is suspended from a buoy at the surface of this lake, which each little buoy has a 15,000 euro GPS, a high precision GPS module, and he pulls the buoy over the artifact and waits for it to quit drifting. This GPS has sub-centimeter precision, so he can tell when it stops drifting around because of the precise GPS, and then it records where each and every one of these little artifacts is precisely located. Fabulous project to be working on. And then I'm just also a couple of weeks ago got hooked up with a team that is putting some electronics similar to the balloon stuff on rhinoceroses in Malawi that has a little bit of a special sensor on it that is they're hoping will detect the approach of poachers in the middle of the night and send an alert to the game warden saying, hey, the rhinoceros that's at this location is possibly in trouble. You might want to come out and see. So it's an amazingly rich graph of connections here. And if my talk ended right here, I would be pretty pleased with myself. I would have bragged for 15 minutes about all the cool stuff I get to do because of the way I've been fiddling my whole life. But the talk doesn't end here because the best part is I think still to come. The best part is that in addition to myself making all these connections, somehow, and I admit in ways that were completely unpredicted by me, this kind of puzzle box technology has enabled other people to connect to each other in completely unexpected ways. And it's allowed people to exhibit some artistry using this funny technology as kind of a canvas in ways I admit I would have never predicted, but are intensely rewarding, and hence the title of this talk, which is Quest Poetry. So if you'll allow me, I'll close by telling three short tales. These are all true stories of things that have been done by other people with puzzle boxes, or are planned to be done, or in the process of being done by other people. And this is the best part of the talk of all, from my perspective. Story number one. A woman a couple of years ago wrote me from California. Her father was having a significant birthday. I think he was turning 65. And she told me that she wanted to do something kind of special for him. He and his wife had flown all the way from New Hampshire out to Pasadena to visit their daughter and have a little special birthday party, at which she presented him a box just like this one. When he pushed the button on it, it said, "Your destination is 2,600 miles away." Well, there's a lot of places that are 2,600 miles away from Pasadena. But they were thinking, New Hampshire's kind of one of those places, sort of. Maybe our daughter programmed this box to open back at home. So let's go back home and push the button when we get home, and we'll see if that's correct. Well, it was almost correct. They got back home, pushed the button, so they tell me. And we're still 90 miles away from where we need to be. So one weekend is, I understand it, the couple got in the car, started driving off into the New England wilderness, hunting for where the box might be programmed to open. And they kept getting closer and closer. You know, you can keep pushing the button, it tells you, now you're 50 miles, now you're 20 miles, now you're 6 miles away. And it sort of became clear as they went deeper and deeper into the wilderness that apparently the place that their daughter had chosen for their puzzle box to open was the old ski resort that they used to go to when Jessica, the daughter, was just a little girl. But, you know, they hadn't been there in 30 years. It seemed, you know, kind of an unlikely choice for a destination. You know, why would you choose that? And I might just interrupt myself to tell you that while you're thinking of your own destinations and recipients and treasures, the best puzzle box quests are the ones, as you can imagine, where there's a great resonance between the destination, the treasure that's in the box, and the recipient you've chosen. If you can get those to really resonate, like Jessica does in this story, then you have made kind of a piece of performance art, a piece of art for sure. Anyway, they get to the ski resort. It clearly is the destination. Pull into the parking lot. It's the middle of the summer. There's nobody there. Box opens up, and what do you think Jessica has put inside the box? Hard to imagine what she could put. So they open it up. There's an old lift ticket from 30 years ago, some other old memorabilia, ski lift times and stuff from 30 years ago, and then a stack of Polaroid photos showing young, just 7-year-old Jessica skiing with her dad, hand in hand, down the mountain. And then a sentimental little letter saying, "Dad, thanks for holding my hand whenever I needed you. Thanks for being there with me. I love you." And this story comes to me from Jessica through the mother, who reports that as soon as they digested all this, the both of them burst into tears. So I think about, when was the last time you had a present that you gave to somebody that caused them to, 65-year-old man, no less, burst into tears? That's something to think about. Makes me teary-eyed just to think about it now. Story number two. This comes from a young man who wrote me from South Africa. Here's the young man. He has a girlfriend. The girlfriend has a grandfather who's recently passed away. She's intensely bereaved. She was very fond of this granddad, and indeed the whole town was very fond of this guy. He's an eccentric old character, beloved by everyone, loved and respected by the whole community. He was a little eccentric, and he was known for the habit of every day after work he would trudge up, as I imagine him, to the top of this little hill that overlooked the sea or the town, I don't know which, but there's a little bench there. And he would always bring 2 bottles of Jamaican Red Stripe beer and drink them on this bench while he's looking out over the ocean. And the daughter, this young man's girlfriend, says that was some of the happiest memories of her life, was waiting for her granddad to come home from work, trudging up to the top of the hill, sitting with him while he drank his Jamaican Red Stripe. And that's saying something, because you can't, as far as I understand, you can't even buy Jamaican Red Stripe beer in South Africa. This guy had it imported specially for him. So this is kind of a significant deal for the gentleman. But back to the boyfriend. The boyfriend's who wrote me, his story is that he's making a puzzle box cooler as a present for his girlfriend. And you can probably guess how this is going to work. He's taken this cooler and he's going to put in it 2 bottles of Jamaican Red Stripe beer, and he's going to program it naturally to open at the little bench at the overlook looking out over the ocean, the same place that his girlfriend's grandfather used to go every day. And he's going to give it to the girl, who's going to go, "What the hell, you know, what is this?" and have to work through all the mechanics of figuring out what this display means when it comes on and what this button's about, and then digesting, "Well, I guess I have to take this to another place." But he says when the time comes that she figures it out and gets up to the top of this hill and opens the cooler to see what's inside, he says, quote, it will melt her. And it's another one of those stories that you think, wow, that probably will melt her. And I'm going to write that down, because someday I'm going to stand up in front of a bunch of people and share that story. Story number 3, last story. this is in some ways the best of all. There's a young woman who's going to graduate school at the University of London who wrote me. She has this plan. She's building not one but three puzzle boxes like this, and she's giving one to each of her three younger teenage brothers. So here's a 22-year-old woman with three younger teenage brothers, and you can program a puzzle box to open not only at a certain space in the world, but also a certain spot in time too. So she's programmed her three puzzle boxes to open at a certain spot, but only on the corresponding boy's 18th birthday. So the way it works is a little bit complicated. Each boy has a box. Each box has been programmed for that specific boy. Until his 18th birthday, he can push the button all he wants, and it won't reveal anything about where the box opens. In fact, you've got to plug it in and recharge it, because over the course of 5 years, the battery goes, right? But on the boy's 18th birthday, the box suddenly comes to life, and it tells him, you're 26 miles away from your destination. Now, each boy has been given specific instructions that he must solve the quest on his own. This is a solitary endeavor. And that it's kind of a secret thing. You're not supposed to reveal what happens in this. So, don't want to give it away for your younger brothers. But what happens is, she's told me, the boys are going to go on their solitary little quest up into the mountains, where this young woman has buried embedded into the side of the rock face of a mountain, a vault in an inaccessible part of a mountaintop. And as each young man just turned 18, and there's a kind of a rite of passage involved here, arrives at this vault carved into the side of the mountain, his box opens, and what's revealed inside is a stash of photos from that boy's childhood, things to remember, memorabilia from that particular boy's childhood, and a letter from his sister saying, sit down with these items and meditate on them a little bit, then take this key, which is also in the box, open up the vault and put them all in the vault, and when you're done, lock the vault back up, don't tell anyone where you went or what happened, and come back down. And, that story was told to me 3 years ago now, and it still gives me goosebumps on the back of my neck when I think about this rite of passage. Imagine the second boy going up the side of the mountain. He sees all these photos of his childhood, sort of a moving into adulthood. You're departing from your childhood. So it's kind of an emotional thing, and it's this sweet letter from an older sister, and all these items which are to be placed in a vault, and as he looks in the vault, he sees that his older brother's equivalent photo collection is there. It's that kind of story that's kind of turned my life upside down for the last 5 years and makes me really happy to have been fiddling my whole life. I really I've experienced so much joy and connectedness with people that, I find, unfortunately, that I don't have any patience anymore for ordinary things. Everything I play with, I've got to have a little bit of kind of poetry in it, or otherwise I get kind of irritable. And I'm really fortunate to have been deluged by all these little artsy and diversions and delights, and I'm delighted by all the connections it's given me. I've met my new patent attorney friend Anthony, and my friend Jason, who builds circuit boards for me out in California, and three different people who have built boxes, and all the wonderful Creative Mornings people, and the Make ATX people, and now by extension, all you 156 of my new friends. So I'm delighted to have been able to talk for a few minutes, and that's all I really have to say. So thanks for listening.